we've got to distinguish between the original Darwin theory and the successors today creating the neo-Darwinist interpretation. Now, why is that important? It's important for this reason. You see, we as living organisms, humans, have what we call values. We like to think that we're making those choices through the social values that we accept, whether they be straightforward values that we just inherit from our parents, or whether it's because of religious belief or whatever it may come from. Now, if the theory is that you are born selfish, that's a quote from Richard Dawkins, The Selfish Gene, and that you can't help that, you've got to be taught to be cooperative. Well, you do need to do that. You have to teach children cooperation. Of course you do.
Right.
But the point I'm making is that there is no restriction on our ability to choose, and therefore our ability to have moral values and values that matter in society. There's no restriction on that from our genetic makeup. And so it's incorrect to say that genes created us body and mind. Again, that's a quote from The Selfish Gene.
You've stated that Richard Dawkins may not fully grasp your arguments. Do you think this could be due to, say, differences in definitions of some key terms like selfishness or purpose?
Well, it's muddling, I'm afraid, because he uses the word selfish applied to a gene and then confuses it by saying, we are born selfish. That's a direct quote from his book, The Selfish Gene. Now, I think he's confused. You cannot attribute selfishness to a chemical. It is, a chemical can only do what a chemical can do. It will, you know, if it's got the right energies, it will bind with this molecule or that one. But it can't be given any sense in which it's got freedom to choose to go one way rather than another. It's buffeted around by the rest of the chemical environment. So, no, I'm afraid it's a fundamental misunderstanding. Now, you could say, therefore, it's a confusion of language. But I think that doesn't get the essence of my argument. It is that the fundamental assumptions of biology itself don't support the gene-centric view. So I'm saying much more than it's a matter of what words you use and what definitions you use. Yes, there is a muddle over the definition of selfishness and what it really means. But over and above that, there are these straightforward assumptions, dogmas, I call them, of modern biology that just are no longer correct.
Yes.
The central dogma does not exclude the possibility of organisms changing their genomes. We were doing that during the pandemic. Our immune systems were doing that. It doesn't mean that the DNA itself self-replicates. And so I can go on. So I think it's much more than a matter of definitions of words. It's also true to say, in my view, that the molecular biological information on which the neo-Darwinist interpretation of biology relied doesn't support what they claim it does support. It's as simple as that. It's not just definition of words, therefore.
What if someone, or Dawkins, responds and says, hey, this still sounds like an example of natural selection operating at a different level, because how does it differ from traditional accounts of somatic hypermutation or clonal selection in the immune system?
Yes. Curt, I like your questions. Absolutely true.
Thank you.
It's when the immune system changes the DNA, it performs natural selection. You couldn't have got it more accurate. Of course it does. But the point is, it does it within the organism. It doesn't wait for natural selection determining the death or life of me and other organisms, it happens within our body within this lifetime. So, yes, it is using natural selection of the immune system cells, the B cells as they're called, that generate the immunoglobulins and generate many different forms of immunoglobulins. And what the immune system does is to choose the ones that are successful in producing the result. That is natural selection within our bodies. But notice that it's directed, because it's functional. Only the ones that succeeded are told to reproduce, to produce more of that immunoglobulin. The rest are told to die. That is not natural selection. That is a directed, functional process. Our immune systems, thank goodness, are very functional. They are not just random. They use randomness. That's the way I would put it. I call it the harnessing of stochasticity, the use of random changes to generate directed function, to generate purposive response.
So it generates purposive response. It doesn't have a purpose itself?
Good question. And that's an interesting one. It sort of does. Let me put it this way. If you, so we have things that have purposes. We have knives, we have forks, and we know how to eat with them. Now, you can say of the knife and fork, they have purpose, if the purpose has been given to them by the makers of knives and forks. Now, that's one sense of purpose, and I think the immune system has precisely that kind of purpose. That is, it's generated within our bodies. We inherit all of that, of course, from our parents, and it is purposive in that sense, just in the same way as tools that organisms use have purpose, because they're given that purpose by those who create them. But it's deeper than that, because I think it's also correct to say that we as humans have intentional purpose. And that depends on conscious intentionality. It's not dependent on purely chemical processes. So I think that over and above the question of whether individual systems within our body, like the immune system, can be said to have purpose, those can be said to have purpose just as tools do. But over and above that, we have the ability to consciously choose what we wish to do. And incidentally, this is another respect in which Darwin disagreed with the neo-Darwinists. Darwin gave organisms, birds as an example, the ability to choose who they cooperate with, who they mate with. He asked the question, why does the peacock have this extraordinary display, which he shows when he's trying to attract a mate, a peahen who might mate with him? Well, his argument was very simple. It's developed all of that as part of the process of making sure that he mates with the best peahen, or the peahen chooses the best peacock. But the point he made, and he emphasized this in his book in 1871, that's after he published on natural selection, and he said, this is conscious, intentional choice. He didn't mince the words at all. So he was attributing to birds and other organisms by implication, exactly the same kind of ability that we ourselves have. Now, of course, he was running counter to a very important tradition in science ever since Descartes. Descartes, way back in the 17th century, said, well, animals don't have this ability. They're machines. They're just mechanical processes. Well, Darwin would have fundamentally disagreed with that. It's another reason why I say that the neo-Darwinists are not true to Darwin's original theory. He allowed what he calls sexual selection. It's a form of social selection, if you like. Who will cooperate with who in a population? That, he accepted, involved intentionality.
Is it possible for a chemical to have purpose in this sense? Not intentional purpose, but the other form, a biochemical.
Well, a chemical can be a tool, yes. I see what you're getting at, and it's a very good question. Obviously, in one sense, the DNA has purpose that has evolved in the sense that it is its purpose, if you wish, is to transmit the information for making proteins from one generation to another. That's a tool which the living system uses. But that's not purpose in the sense of being anything other than a tool. It's not purpose in the sense in which you and I and other organisms have purposive, intentional behavior.
So what if there's Dawkins here? Somehow Dawkins became constructed right beside me. And he says to you, he says, Dennis, let us bridge this semantic gap. We can have a productive dialogue. You're saying biochemicals like DNA can't be selfish.
Yes.
I'm watering down the usage of the word selfish. But can I not claim the same about you and the word purpose?
That I'm just a bunch of molecules and that therefore I don't really have the sense, or I don't have the reality of having free choice and purposive behavior. Well, I think I would ask him, look, Richard, have a look at what humans are capable of. You are capable of writing a brilliant book. I always call it brilliant because I think it is. The Selfish Gene is a terrifically well-written book. I envy his ability to communicate in the way that he does. But it's nevertheless incorrect. And so I would say, well, you intended to write that book. And you want to tell me you didn't? That you, just your chemicals made you do it? I just don't believe you, Richard. That would be my answer to him, I think.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.